This is a Seeking Delphi special edition, South by Southwest minicast number 4, Extreme Bionics, the Future of Human Ability. Interviews recorded on site in Austin, Texas, March 12, 2018. I'm Mark Sackler. The future lives here. As technology progresses to augment every aspect of human experience, AR, VR, artificial intelligence, it also progresses in the restorative sense as advanced technology increasingly boosts the function to those that might be missing some aspect of standard human biology. In other words, prosthetics. But as we get closer and closer to restoring full function, we rapidly approach a time when extreme function, over and above what we might call normal, is within reach. And not just for those who need prosthetics. I spoke with two rather remarkable participants in this panel. The first is Aimee Mullins. She was born without bones in her legs below the knee, a rare genetic defect. Both lower legs were amputated before her first birthday, so she's never known true, full biological legs. But that has not stopped her from living an amazing life as a Paralympian and as an actress and a model. At times, even using various prosthetic legs as a fashion statement. Aimee, you're kind of a pioneer in this area, having not had your lower legs since you were 1 year old. You've grown up and gone through and helped pioneer a number of different new technologies. So the question I have for you is, in the next 10 or 20 years, what do you think might be added to these technologies that might make them better than what you have right now?
Well, a lot. You know, in the realm of bionics, certainly, powered ankles. You know, that's people have had articulated wrists on prosthetics for a long time. It's not a weight-bearing joint, but the making bionic ankles that are efficient and lightweight. You know, right now they're quite heavy. That's going to happen. Also, I think sensorial prosthetics, where with this closed loop that we talked about in today's session, where it's not just that my brain will send signals to move an ankle of a prosthetic, but also the prosthetic that is walking over gravel, over sand, will be telling my brain what that feels like, or what if the water is hot. You know, right now I don't have any feeling, and my sensation is completely imagined. You know, I imagine what the sand feels like between my toes, but I am hoping for the prosthetic to come very soon that lets me feel it.
Now, you showed us a photo of some new running prosthetics that are illegal because they're powered. Hugh, in his remarks, said he foresees the day with bionic limbs where the Paralympics will have better results than the, let's call them, the natural limb Olympics. Those are individual sports. What about team sports? I mean, you're going to deal with a baseball pitcher with a bionic arm, for example. How would something like that play out, do you think? Have you thought about things like that?
Well, of course I've thought about things like that. I mean, I can give you the parallel that it's already happened in sport. You know, like a cyclist that can afford a titanium bike is going to have an advantage over someone who doesn't. You know, Michael Phelps set how many world records wearing the Speedo laser racer suit. It changes your physiognomy. It helps you compress your core. That translates to hundreds of seconds. Tiger Woods got not one but two LASIK surgeries to change his vision, and so now he can see the fairway more clearly. You know, Tommy John surgery. This is not new in sports, but it's no different than when you look at a team lineup and you see who's batting cleanup. You know, and it was Sammy Sosa or something. You know, you got a pitcher with a bionic arm, maybe that's your star player. I mean, that's your advantage. It's going to happen where we're going to see this kind of integration because people are going to be living much longer. They're going to want to stay relevant in their lives. You know, the idea that those sprinting legs are illegal in competition right now because it's a powered motor, but, you know, the idea that you're going to take them out on a road race is will be your choice. And it's like saying to somebody who's an incredible, you know, Catherine Switzer just ran the marathon again in Boston this year, 50 years after she had done it the first time, and was, I think, something incredible like 20 minutes slower or something than she was in her 20s. But if Catherine has knee replacements or hip replacements, are you going to say, well, you know, that's not really allowed because you've changed your body? Everyone's changing their body throughout their whole lives, and it's just a matter of us continue to having open conversations about what we want the sport to reflect, what values we want our sport to reflect. If the idea of fairness, what does fairness mean? What does cheating mean? And how do we, in the way that we do with golf, you know, tournaments with teams, how do we stack teams so that we feel there is a level playing field amongst the diversity?
The prosthetics that Aimee was wearing were lifelike enough, at a casual glance, to pass for real lower legs. On the other hand, this second panelist sported metallic prosthetics that, well, made him look more like Mr. Robot than Mr. Robot. Hugh Herr of MIT's Media Lab lost his lower legs at age 18 due to frostbite suffered in a mountain climbing mishap. He also talked about pairing the nervous system with artificial limbs.
Hugh Herr, you talked about the future, and that's what I like to talk about. Something, it was neurological
embodiment,
right. What is that and why is it important?
So I define neurological embodiment as something that occurs and is achieved when we link the design world, electromechanics, into the nervous system in a very intimate way. Where not only can a person think and actuate their synthetic body part, but they can feel the synthetic body part, and the synthetic computation on that body part can put energy into the energy and information into the human. So when that happens, it's no longer a tool. The person feels the synthetic part of their body, and therefore it becomes part of their body and part of self.
Now, you said something very interesting, kind of to shift gears a little bit here, about bionics, functional, to the point where maybe the results in the Paralympics 10 or 15 years down the road will be better than in, let's call it, the standard, naturally endowed Olympics. That calls to question the potential for using them to enhance natural abilities in other areas, industrial warfare, astronauts. What are your thoughts on that? Do you see that coming, and how soon?
Oh, absolutely, and it's happening now. So in 2014, my lab at MIT was the first to design and test an exoskeleton that augments human walking speed and metabolism. Humans with perfectly normal, healthy legs. So there's a number of groups throughout the world that are using electromechanics to extend humans beyond innate physiological levels.
Are there any specific applications you see in the immediate future?
Oh, there's tons of applications. I think we can unload biological joints in something like running on rigid surfaces and avoid surgeries later in life. And also, these augmentation technologies will simply be fun. You know, if you gave me an exoskeleton where I could be bipedal and be an agile as my own biological legs, but I could run really fast and I wouldn't even breathe hard, and I could run through the wilderness jumping over logs and rocks, wow, that would be so much better than a mountain bike. I would love to have that invention. It would be remarkably fun.
I have to admit, in closing, that I disagree somewhat with Aimee Mullins about bionic limbs in team sports. If there were no limits, then at some point it would become less of a competition of athletics and more of technology. On the other hand, I wouldn't mind bionic shoulders and thumb joints that would allow me to enjoy a pain-free golf game again. And okay, I wouldn't turn down 400-yard drives either. My thanks to IEEE and InterPros for helping to arrange these interviews as part of the IEEE Tech for Humanity series at South by Southwest 2018. Until next time, I'm Mark Sackler.